Supabase Storage makes it easy to handle image uploads and downloads in your apps. Today, we are adding image support to our Figma Clone app. This is episode 4 of Create a Figma Clone App Using Flutter and Supabase series. Let's dive in! Before getting into any storage-related configurations, we need some UI to get started with uploading images. So just like the actual Figma, let's create a panel on the right side. This panel will be a simple stateless widget. We can give it a container with the same color as the app bar. Give it some width, and let's go add it to the canvas page. Add the right panel widget within the row. Now we have a simple panel on the right. Come back to the right panel widget and let's add some properties. We need the currently selected canvas object and a function to communicate the change happening to that canvas object to the parent. Now let's add some content to this container. When there's no object passed to this right panel, we can just show a blank UI. When there is an object, we can show a list view. In the actual Figma, this is where you can change the property of the selected object, like colors and width and whatnot. But for right now, we are going to just have a single button to upload an image to this canvas object. Now let's create a method to upload an image to Supabase Storage once the button is pressed. In order to upload the image, we are going to use the image picker plugin. Copy the snippet and paste it into pubspec.yaml. Once we have the image picker plugin, we can proceed to uploading images. Create an image picker instance and call the picImage method. Pass the image source.gallery and specify the max width and height just to be safe. Once we have the image, we can decode the image into bytes and specify where this image file will be stored in. But we don't have a Supabase storage bucket yet, so let's go create one. From the Supabase dashboard, head to Storage. Then press New Bucket. We can name our new bucket Canvas Object. There are some additional safeguards that we can put in place. First, we can restrict the maximum file size of this bucket. I'm going to set this to 5 megabytes. Then we can set the allowed MIME types. For this particular app, we'll restrict it to JPEGs and PNGs. Hit save and the bucket is created. Let's go back to the code. So the storage path just needs to be unique across the bucket. We can pass the object ID as well as some datetime random string so that it'll play out nicely with the caching we'll implement later. Once we know where to store the object, we can call the uploadBinary method on the Supabase Flutter library. This method takes the storage path, the image bytes, and some file options. In the file options, we can pass the image MIME type as well as whether we want to perform an upsert or not. In this application, we'll not be performing any overrides of storage objects, but I personally like to keep upsert set to true. Once the upload is complete, we can call the onObjectChange method to let the parent widget know that the object upload was complete. We also need to make some modification to the CanvasObject class. We need to add properties to hold the image information. We add two properties, one called ImagePath, which contains the string representation of the image path, and the other called image, which is type of image from the .ui package. Let's also adjust the imports up here. Now we need to add the image path and image properties to all existing subclasses. Basically just going around and filling up all the places that is showing errors. We are almost there. Lastly, let's modify the copy width method of the canvas object class. Add image path and image parameters. This allows us to call the copy width method, passing the image path parameter without casting it as its subclass. Now we can pass the parameters to the right panel widget. The object will be just a selected object from the canvas objects variable, and onObjectChange will be a custom method. We first update the local state, then sync the state with the other connected clients. Now the sync canvas method takes the cursor position as the required argument, and we don't have the cursor position here, so we need to make some adjustments. It's a bit of a quick and dirty fix, but we can just make cursor position optional, and adjust all the errors accordingly. And with a few adjustments, I think all the errors are gone. Let's check out if we can upload an image to our storage bucket. call the upload image method upon pressing the button. We can draw an object on the canvas, select the object, and press the upload button. Choose image, and we get an error. This error is happening because we haven't set any row-level security policies for our storage buckets. So let's create some policies. From the dashboard, we can get started with creating policy for our storage bucket. This is a mechanism that Supabase has to protect your storage bucket from malicious users. If your users are authenticated, you can restrict which authenticated users can perform what action against your storage bucket. In this particular application though, we are not authenticating anybody, so let's just give every single person select, insert, update, and delete permissions. Note that this is really not secure, so do not do this in an actual production application. Give the policy some name, specify the target roles to Anon because every single person is not going to be signed out, and save the policy. Great, the users should be able to upload some images. Let's refresh the page and get started again. Draw a rectangle, upload an image, and we are not getting any errors. Go back to the Supabase dashboard and let's check out the bucket. And we see the image that we just uploaded. Great. Now let's get into the fun part, drawing the image on the canvas. Flutter provides great APIs to easily draw images on the canvas. Within the loop of drawing each canvas object, we can extract the image variable from the canvas object. Now, if there is an image set for this particular canvas object, we can call canvas.saveLayer. We'll come back and create a bounding rect property for the canvas object later. Now go to the bottom of the loop after drawing all the shapes. Once all the shapes are drawn, we can call the paintImage method. This paintImage method, combined with the saveLayerImage that we called up there, paints the image on whatever shapes we have on the canvas. Okay, let's create a bounding rect getter. This will return the rectangle bounding whatever shapes we have. For circles, it's pretty simple. We just have a center and the width and height are both 2 times the radius. For rectangle, it's even simpler. We just literally provide the rectangle that we have. Now the custom painter is ready to draw the image, but we haven't loaded the image properly yet. And to do that, we are going to create a method called loadImage. We can call this loadImage method once the upload is complete to asynchronously load the image from Supabase Storage. We can define the method somewhere up here. We can import the image class from the .ui package. We can add a basic check to make sure that image path property does exist for this particular object. Now Supabase Storage has a convenient method called download which returns a image byte list. And once we have the image byte list, we just need to call decode image from list and we get the image class. Once we have that, we just need to update the local state providing the new image class that we just obtained. Now that is it. We should be able to upload and view the image on our canvas now. We can draw a rectangle and upload an image. Once the upload and download is complete, we see the image, but we lost the right panel. So let's look into that. Turns out I had forgotten to call the canvas.restore method. Remember that we called canvas.saveLayer up there? The saveLayer and the restore method work together to bundle whatever is between them. Now let's see if it's fixed. We can draw a rectangle, upload an image. Great, the image shows up. Let's draw a circle and do the same. Great, the image shows up cropped to the circle. Now in order to display the image on the other connected clients, we need to call the loadImage method after we get the object back from the onBroadcast callback. Let's come back to the canvas, draw a rectangle, and upload an image. Now once the upload is complete, we can move the image around and we see the right side window glitching. This is because it's downloading the image every single time it receives a broadcast message. We can fix this by introducing a simple caching layer. Let's create an image cache variable. This will contain all the images that are already downloaded. We can check if the image is already stored in the cache. If it is, we just return that. If not, we download a new image from Supabase Storage and add it to the cache. Let's see how it looks. Draw a rectangle, upload an image. The image doesn't show up until we start dragging, which we'll fix later. But other than that, the image looks beautiful. We can draw another circle and upload the image. And we can also drag this around, and it looks perfectly in sync. It's working beautifully. Let's go back and fix this small bug that we have. Within the onObject change, we can also set the selected object ID to the target object's ID again. This ensures that the selected object ID will sync the image path to the other clients. Now that we have a basic image upload working, let's go into some bonus stage. We are adding a feature that supports polygon. Basically, we're going to have a pen tool type of thing where the users can click multiple times within the canvas and it'll create a polygon connecting those dots. All the building blocks are there, so we can just create a class called polygon that extends the canvas object. And then basically we need to fill up all the required methods. Polygons will have two unique properties, points and isClosed. The bounding rect, I'm just going to paste what I have on my cheat sheet, but basically it's finding the smallest and largest x and y coordinates and creating a rectangle around that. For the intersects width, Flutter has a handy method using path and contains. Move is just shifting all the points by delta. Let me create a copy width method down here. We can fix that error by fixing the constructor. I'm also just going to paste the 2JSON from my cheat sheet, but nothing too special going on here. Once the polygon model is done, let's go into the canvas page. Let's create a new draw mode called pen. Now the pen tool is unique because we no longer just drag and drop. We call the pan down method multiple times to draw the shape. So let's add it to the on pan down method. There's two cases here. One case is we're already drawing the polygon, and the other case is we haven't started drawing and we are starting to draw the polygon just now. We can create a variable called isDrawingPolygon, which determines whether we are already drawing polygon or we are just getting started with it. Essentially, what we're looking for is do we have an open polygon or not? The polygon is open while it's being drawn, and it's closed once it's done drawing. If we are already drawing a polygon, all we do is we add a point. We can add an addPoint method to the polygon class. Now if we are just getting started with drawing the polygon, we can create a new polygon instance and assign it to the canvas object. Now we hadn't created the create new constructor, so let's create it right here. A new polygon will have a single point and it's not closed. We'll assign it random ID, random color, and no image or image path. For pan update, we're basically going to do nothing. The actual Figma lets you bend the lines when you pan update, but we're not gonna go that deep in this video. For pan in, we want to keep the polygon being selected, so we just wrap it inside an if statement. Actually, if we are just done drawing any general shapes, then we should change the drawing mode from whatever it was, rectangle or circle, to pointer. And we can just delete the part where we assign null to selected object ID. Wrap this inside a set state and we're good to go. Let's also adjust the custom painter so that we can draw these polygons. if the canvas object is polygon. If the canvas object is not closed, we are just drawing the strokes. We can do so by setting the paint.style to paintingStyle.stroke. Now from there on, we basically just need to draw each point. Starting from the first one, we loop through all the other points. And at the end, if the object is closed, we call path.close. Now let's take a look at what we got. Select the pen tool, and we can start drawing. Great, but how do we end the drawing? Let's go back to the code and change the UI a bit. While we're drawing a polygon, we are going to display a done button at the top left. Go to the leading. We are adding a new button right here, conditionally. And the condition is whether we are drawing a polygon or not. So let's check again if our currently selected object is an open polygon. If it is, let's display a failed button. The text should say done. Within the onPress, all we need to do is update the polygon to closed and sync the information to other clients. We can create a new method called close to close the polygon. Let's also change the drawing mode to pointer. And remember to sync the state to other clients. We can also hide these buttons up here when we are drawing a polygon. Let's go check out what we have. We can connect the dots and hit done. It's not syncing over. Let's try uploading an image. Looks pretty cool, but it's still not syncing over. Let's go back and see what's wrong. And it actually turns out that we forgot to implement FromJSON for the Polygon class. So first, let's go up to the FromJSON method of the canvas object. And make sure that we return the FromJSON of the Polygon class. Then we can go down and create the FromJSON constructor. Again, nothing too special going on, just one by one constructing all the properties of the Polygon class. And we are done. Let's go check out what we have. We can draw a polygon, connect multiple dots. And we can even upload an image, and it'll be cropped to the shape of the polygon. And that's how you can get started with Supabase Storage on your Flutter apps. It's pretty cool to see those images being cropped in different shapes on the canvas, huh? In the next episode, we'll look at how we can persist the state of the canvas on our Supabase database. I'll see you around. Bye.